My name is Roy Nouriel. I'm a director of product management at Perfecto. This is my second time in India, in Bangalore, and I'm extremely excited to come here again. I landed at 3 a.m. You will see part of the experience that I had on my way from the airport to the hotel, but I'm excited to be here. I think that India and Bangalore are one of the places that most of the development and testing work is done. And for me, it's a great opportunity, you know, to engage, to learn, and to see how we can make things better in the future. This session is not about Perfecto, but for those who don't know Perfecto, we provide continuous quality lab that support mobile and digital. And again, that session is not going to talk about Perfecto. And if you have any question, feel free to come later on and ask. Sree, do you want to present yourself?
Yeah, my name is Sreevatsa. So I'm responsible for the India region. So I'm enabling the partners on the technical and also the non-technical stuff. Yeah, that's me. And I'm from Bangalore.
And he is from Bangalore. Sorry for that. Okay, so let's start. How many of you have iPhones over here? If you can raise your hand. So it means that you are more tired than I am, because I'm sure that all the others also have smartphones, right? If you don't have a QR scanner, now it's a good time to install it. You may use it later on during the session, okay? So we'll get to it later. Today we are going to talk about pyramids and how the approach for testing changed as we see it, and the main idea is to share with you a new concept for testing for mobile and digital applications, okay? The pyramids have been here, and not those one, I mean those one, as an approach for mobile test, I mean for test automation in general, for the last, I think, 10 to 15 years. Who is familiar with those concept? I mean, and it was mentioned earlier today, the pyramid, the unit, integration test. So there are many flavors to those pyramids, and in fact, they make a lot of sense when you try to understand what is your automation strategy, okay? And let's talk about what's the main concept behind all of those pyramids that we saw. So basically, when we come and decide what should we automate and how we should build our automation, so there are many things that we need to take into account. And part of that is what coverage we want to achieve. Another one is how fragile is the automation suite that we are building. And the lower that we go in the technology stack, we have more stable tests. So if we start with unit test, it's basically, it's a white box testing, right? That you, usually the developers develop, and they test mainly the functions, okay? As I see it, it's a huge safety net with big holes in it, but you get immediate feedback. So you get two things. You get a good coverage, and you get a fast feedback, and it's important. And that's why that concept recommended to have the majority of your tests as unit tests. So that's the first layer. The second one is basically an API, which is more a black box testing, which is you test the application, the components of the applications, but on the interface layer, okay? There were some discussions during this conference about how to build your test, and that's an important layer. Again, you go one level up, it takes more to develop those automation assets. They provide a more accurate feedback on the quality of the application because they test it from the outside in and not from the inside out. And they give you a very good coverage. And usually, they are stable. By the way, usually, traditionally, those two layers were developed by developers, right? Who developed over here unit tests? Okay, are you a developer? QA? Okay, so that it happened occasionally, but usually those tests are developers' kind of tests, right? API is somewhere in between, and the more we go up, we have more QA traditional tests. The UI layer is basically, we're here in Selenium conference, so Selenium and other tools that automate the UI layer, which basically give you a good understanding of the quality of your application, and we'll touch, what change when we're looking at mobile and web application. Does this make sense? All of you are familiar with this pyramid? Okay, any question before we move forward? Okay, so what changed? And let's try to see what changed.
I bought something from you last week, and I'm very disappointed.
Oh yeah? What's the problem?
Yeah, well, my BlackBerry is not working.
What's the matter? Run out of juice?
No, it's completely frozen.
Oh yeah, I see that. I'll tell you what. Let's try it on orange.
That's got a few black spots, you see.
Oh dear, yeah, sorry about that.
Well, now I need to get my BlackBerry working.
Well, it could be an application issue. But where do you store that BlackBerry? It's on my desktop. Well, you could try using a mouse to drag the BlackBerry to the trash. And after you've done that, you might want to launch the BlackBerry from the desktop.
Well, I've already tried that a few times. I mean, all it did was mess up Windows.
Well, it might be worth waiting a couple of weeks. They've got the latest BlackBerrys coming in then. Well, could you give me a date?
Certainly. Put that date in my diary. Anything else I can help you with?
Yes, yes. I've also got a problem, to be honest.
With my apple.
Ooh, dear, oh dear, that is an old apple, isn't it? When did you buy that?
At last week.
Last week?
Oh, they brought out two new apples since then.
What's the problem with it?
Well, I'm trying to put my dongle in here, and it won't fit.
Oh, yeah.
Things, but my wife's seen a few dongles in her time, and she says a little bit on the small side. I find there's not a lot I can do about it.
Tell you what, let me try boosting it.
That's great. Anything else I can help you with?
Well, funny enough, yes, my grandson's birthday soon.
Okay. Now, he's already got an apple and a BlackBerry. I mean, have you got anything else he might just like?
Well, we're doing a special offer on these. I mean, I can't make head or tail of them, but the kids seem to like them. Xbox. 360.
There are a few things that changed, and let's talk about them. The pyramid was designed for a three-tier application, okay? Where basically the main logic of the application was in the backend, and the client side was a thin client, okay? The browser or any client was a thin client. So it made a perfect sense to test on the backend, okay? So then unit test and system kind of test, API test, made perfect sense. But you guys are here in Selenium conference, and it means that you test web applications, right? Web or mobile application. And as part of that, you can see, I just took one diagram, but there are tons of diagrams. We all know that the majority of the transactions that are coming to website are coming through mobile devices, okay? So, I met a few customers last week, and we talked about test strategy. And basically what they told me, the majority of them, that around 60 to 70% of the access to the websites is coming through mobile. From any kind of platform, it can be either tablets and smartphones or any kind of platform, okay? And that changed the way that your applications behave, which means that if I'm not testing that client, I basically test my application in an isolated environment, okay? That it means that I cannot predict the quality level of my application, which basically that's the main idea when we build our test strategy, right? To know how the application will behave at the end of the day. More than that, those devices are much more complex than desktops, right? They have tons of sensors that change the behavior of the application. So if I opened yesterday my browser to engage with one of the application, it immediately asked me if I give the application access to my location, right? Or any other sensor that I have here. How many of you test your application on different locations? How many of you test your application when you rotate the device? Okay, that's an important thing to validate. Because, you know, when we talk about web application, when you rotate a device, it immediately behaves different. And there are many cases that the application will either crash or disappear. It immediately changes the location that the user was engaging with your application. We are much more sensitive in our era to quality because quality is visible for everyone, right? If we're talking about mobile applications, so we have the app stores. And if we're talking about web application, social media is killing everyone, right? Immediately, if you release a crappy application, it's immediately in the news. And the sensor adds huge complexity here. So let's take a few examples. And I promised you that I will share with you a moment. And at Perfecto, we call them the digital moment that I had yesterday. So I had a delay in my flight. I landed in Bangalore, exhausted after 2 days from my trip from Boston. I tried to order Uber, okay? And I was surrounded with people that were able to book their Uber from their phone, but I couldn't. That's my screen. You see it happened at 2 a.m. and it didn't work, which basically means that someone at Uber didn't validate that if I come with a phone from the U.S., there is a problem with roaming and maybe something else, I don't know. But that was the experience. So I couldn't order Uber, and I went and I took a regular taxi. Okay, that's immediately loss of business. And those devices equal to your company's huge number of money. Digital changed the perception of IT towards those applications equals money. That's where the money is going to, from branches to software development. And one of our hobbies at Perfecto, we like to collect those embarrassing moments, and I can share with you tons of them. Some of them related to the network environment, some of them relate to other applications that are installed on your device, as I said, rotation, location. I don't know where it's, I have a funny one here that your location is not valid, please change your location, okay? Which doesn't make sense, right? So let's talk how we approach this change. So what stands behind that, and that's a concept that, you know, we've built internally and we validated with our customers, and I would be very happy to get your point of view to understand if that makes sense to you. So what we're saying is that from automation perspective, it makes perfect sense to keep this logic of the pyramid, which means still we believe that the unit layer is significantly important and we still need to invest here, the same the integration and the UI layer. But what we are saying, you already made an investment on the UI layer. Make sure that you're testing your application in a way that it will replicate your end user environment, and basically you're doing end user experience validation, right? That's what you need to do. And that's what changed. And that's why we called it the hourglass. So what we're saying is that you should take the UI layer and validate that on multiple environments. So if we're talking about web, web introduced huge complexity of environments, because right now you have huge number of browsers that are getting updated very frequent, right? And in addition, we talked about mobile, that you need to validate on multiple devices. So devices, we have the different operation systems, the different carriers, CPU, you know, we didn't even touch wearables and how they impact the way that you need to test. Okay, but that's one dimension. So if you have 10 tests, we'll touch in a second how you need, which devices you need to select, and you should multiple and execute those tests and multiple them on the right and relevant environment, okay? And that's a work that requires a joint effort from the QA to the guys also from the operation side that can tell you which environments your end user are engaging with, and more than that, to know the landscape of your market and which new devices and which new browsers are going to come to the market soon. Because, for example, we're talking today, Apple released now all of their iOS 10 versions that are going to hit the market immediately, because the moment that they release it, the adoption happens in 48 hours, right? We know that. And you need to be ready. And part of that is also to test the beta versions that they release. And you need to know the landscape. The second dimension is basically the environment, okay? So to understand what different networks you need to test, what different orientation you need to test. And you can see over here the different parameters that you need to take into account, and that's how you build your test strategy. And when we're talking about agile development process, you don't have enough time for that, and that's where automation is crucial, right? Who do they take into account those parameters when you build your test strategy? Do you want to share? Good. Basically, what it means is that if you're not doing it, your test cannot predict how your end user will experience your application. Okay, and I shared with you a few examples, and we can share more. And the data is another parameter that I'm sure that you're taking into account, right? That's not new. But digital application changed that perspective. Does this make sense to you, or you think, you know, it's a, you know, a nice idea, but not more than that? Makes sense? So I want to share with you, that's, as I said, we're not talking about Perfecto, but that's a free tool, okay, that you can use today. I will share with you in a second how you do it, that you can use today to understand which devices you should test. Let's see if we have it here already open. Okay, so that's basically a tool that we share that give you the ability to build, understand which devices you need to take into account. We have a few other tools that you can play with that also give you different browsers that you should look at. So what you can see over here, you can define which locations are relevant for your customers. Okay, and that's important. Usually, by the way, you can get this information from the operation side. They can tell you where the transactions are coming from. It also helps you to understand what is the risk that it introduces. You can change what is the primary environment, what operating system, and if you have your own data, which devices are more common for you, you can play with it. So I need your help here with your computer, because can you scroll down a little bit? Okay, perfect. So those are the devices that basically that we recommend you. And you can see over here the deviation between the different environments, which help you to understand which devices are more important for you based on the inputs that you provided. Can you scroll a little bit down? So I will give you later on the link, but basically it also gives you the landscape, okay? Which means which devices are coming soon that you need to take into account. Let's move forward. I don't want to waste too much time on that. Okay, so I told you that you should have your QR code. That's basically a link if you want to play with this tool. By the way, the slides will be available later on, so you can also get it later. But that's a link to get this tool. One last thing before I hand it over to Sri. I've mentioned earlier that Agile introduced a huge challenge how you embed those activities earlier. There were a few discussions in this conference that talked about taking the assets and embed them into the continuous quality, continuous integration. That's a high-level suggestion that if you want, I can take it over and deep dive. That's a conversation that you guys need to do with your developers and to take your assets, because you develop, if you're here, it means that you develop with Selenium, right? Which make perfect sense for the developers. Usually it's the same platform, the same technology stack that they're using, to take that and embed that into their continuous integration server and provide fast feedback. And when you do that, take into account both the environment that you're covering as well as the environment that you're covering, okay? And that should be part of your strategy and point of view when you talk about coverage, okay? One exercise that I like to do, I come to our customers and I ask them, what is your automation coverage, okay? And then they tell me 60%. Then we start to drill down. What when you say 60%, what do you mean, right? And after we have this conversation, usually it ends up with 20% coverage, right? And it's a matter of decision, but they should be aware to what is the coverage that they have, okay? At the end of the day, the user is the most important thing. That's what you guys are here. You're responsible for the quality and the engagement of the user through the different platforms, right? So that's really in a high level. Before I hand it to Sri to give you some technical insight on how you can execute that in parallel and integrate that into the CI. Any question before I hand it over to Sri? Perfect. Good.
So the explanation from Roy on shifting our focus or enhancing the focus from the traditional triangle or the pyramid towards the hourglass, right? So it is not only important for us to validate on the UI, but now giving the challenge of the number of channels through which a user can access your application is many. So this has to be taken into consideration. So the left part where we targeted on devices, right? And when we talk about the devices or on the machines, so we also talk about the OS which are running, the OS level, maybe the browser which they are using, right? So on the left hand side. And on the right hand side, the other important part. So as Vinny said, it's all about experience. Right? So if the experience, but not only with respect to the mobile in general, if the experience is bad, then you will never go to that hotel or to that shop. Right? So how do I capture the user experience? So there are various factors which will affect the user experience. So when we think a tester as an end user, then you can figure it out. Like, what is affecting my mobile application? So the right side of the hourglass, so was trying to capture the end user preferences or the conditions of your end user. So the demo part, which showcases is a pretty straightforward one. So this example just focuses on pre-learning the desktop browser, so which we are aware, like Firefox or Chrome, Internet Explorer. So no matter which browser we have, which browser versions we have, so luckily we have Selenium, which can take care much on this one, right? And with the usage of, so this is one of the insurance websites, which is part of the decodes and space. So we have Selenium script, which is running on this device, on the local machine and on the Firefox. So what's important now when we talk about the left part of the test devices is that we have to cover more. So it is not only the local machines or the local browsers which we are focusing on. Now we have to enhance the execution towards the devices as well. So as Roy was pointing out, so many of the customers say 70 or even much more percentage for many of the websites are coming from the mobile browsers, right? So it becomes important for us, so not only to run things on the local machines and the local browsers which are on the desktop, but also the mobile browser. So in this example, it happens. So we call it as the Vastu Dosha sometimes, right? So you are at the conference and it doesn't run. But nevertheless, so the focus is on the local execution as well as, so we have to ensure that things work on the devices as well. So luckily we have the new concept of responsive web design, which is being widely accepted and implemented, where it becomes where it gives us the flexibility to write on one and execute on many. So the same case where we are running on the desktop browser as well as the device browser. So it is important for us to cover the various platforms through which our business is carried out, right? So in this case, so we have used the Perfecto thing, where we are able to run the same script on the device browser as well as desktop browser. So one thing when it comes to the test automation, the good part is we are able to save time. And even the left part of the hourglass, where we have n number of devices, n number of browsers, right? So how do we achieve these things? So not only automation is one of the pillar, but to support this pillar, we need a component or a good cement, which is called as parallel execution, right? So until and unless we do automation and along execute them parallelly, so we cannot achieve the left part of the hourglass, right? So in this case, so we have used the Selenium and along the combination of test engine, so we are able to do what we need. Right? So thank you on that. So I'll hand it over to you.
By the way, how many of you are testing your, do you have a responsive web application? Yeah, so that started to become a huge, huge challenge, right? You need to test different screen resolution, and the validation is a huge pain, right? So that's in a nutshell what I want to share with you guys today. We're here, so you can come over. We can talk about how you can implement those kind of things and help you with that. The concept, as well as to talk about responsive web and some of the challenges that we see over there, and would be great to talk with you, understand what are the challenges that you guys face, right? Different resolutions and how you test them, the differences between real devices and emulators, especially when you test responsive web applications. That's the QR to the slides, so you can get it from there. If you want, you can come over and I will send you a copy of the slides. Thank you very much. And if you have questions, now is the time for questions.
Thanks for the presentation. Do you believe responsive web is going to be the next big thing? Or since you have built Google apps, you have hybrid apps, mobile apps. So do you see a mobile web is going to be one of the next big thing we should focus on, because mostly many people, many businesses on mobile doesn't prefer web. They opt to, you know, make apps or hybrid apps. And hybrid apps, they transition to native apps. So
that. So it's a good question, and honestly, I don't know the answer, okay? And I can tell you what we see, okay? What we definitely see, that organizations are moving and refactoring their website towards responsive web. They understand that the website is no longer good enough for multiple platforms, okay? And we see huge projects that migrate existing websites to responsive websites. On the other side, it doesn't mean that they let go to their native application or hybrid application. The distinguish between native or hybrid is more around the engagement that you want to give to your end user on the cost of developing two different applications, right? And it really depends what kind of application, etc. But usually they have both, the web application and the native or hybrid application for different purposes. I can tell you that what I've seen, that organization originally planned to develop a native application for tablets, and they closed those projects and moved to responsive web application. So for smartphone, usually the notion is that we would like to have native applications, and for any other resolution, we want to cover that with responsive web.
Can I ask another question subsequent? So from this response, I see there's no need of tools like or some other tools, because I can other ways use a little grid to make, you know, to simulate mobile behavior or mobile sizes by using Chrome extensions or something to use a little grid, and you don't have coverage. I need the left side of your arguments.
So I'm not sure that I understood the question. I followed you, but I didn't see the question mark at the end.
Okay. So what I'm trying to say is, why do I need to use scripts that are developed for web have a coverage on mobile and use tools like these?
So basically that was what I tried to achieve with this session, right? That when you're doing it only on browser, basically you're missing your users, also for web. Right, and the example that I gave, some of them are for native or hybrid application, but some of them are for web. And web, as I said at the beginning, web, most of the transactions today for web coming through mobile devices. And then you need to make sure what happened if your application asked for location, orientation. So that was part of the concept. Okay, any more question? So I will ask you a question, a request, okay? One of my commitments that I came to present here, that in my sessions I'm not going to talk about Perfecto. And if you want, obviously I will be very happy to have a conversation with you about why we're different than the others, but let's do it separately,
sure,
okay? Okay, so you should know. It's, there is a say that I ask not since I wanted to know, I wanted that everyone else will know, but that's, Any more questions? So you guys are ready for lunch. So thank you very much, and I hope that you enjoyed the conference, and we're here. We're happy to talk. Thank you very much.